Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron here, New Life Pentecostal Church, Albany, Georgia. Hope you're having a great day in Jesus. Well, we're starting back our discussions in Scripture series, a journey through the book of Genesis. And we're in Genesis 15 and 4, so you may want to turn there in your Bible. Just a verse-by-verse study. We've done most of the book of Romans. Hope to complete that. And then, Lord willing, we're going to go into Proverbs. So, Genesis 15, 4, this is life of Abraham, you know, starting basically in Genesis chapter 12 on through Genesis 24. And so it says, and behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, now, want to stop there. The word of the Lord came unto him. So there's several times in the Old Testament appears that the word of the Lord or the voice of God came in a personalized manner. Now, of course, the Word was with God, the Word was God, just like my Word is with me, but it is me. It's not a separate person. But it would be as, I guess it was Victor or Zephyrinus, one of the early Roman bishops in the 180, 190 era, would say that the Father is the invisible, Jesus is the visible. And so that the Word was a manifestation of God that could be beheld maybe by the angels and that type thing, because we know God dwells in the light. He's invisible. First Timothy says, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth, he has revealed him. So this appears, many people would term this theologically a theophany, but the word of the Lord would come, and the word of the Lord was the Father. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Father, and the Word was the Father. All right, so not a separate person. So the word of the Lord comes to him, just again, like the voice of the Lord walked in the garden, Genesis 3:8. There's several instances as we go through the Bible, we'll see this. This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. So they have found in the Nutsi tablets, many other tablets, Telarmana, others, that in the ancient Near East, that the steward many times would be declared the heir if the person was childless. And so the word of God comes to Abraham and says, nada. That is not happening. One that's going to come out of you is going to be your heir. And remember, Abraham was getting older. Romans 4 tells us his body was now dead, and Sarah's body was dead. And what it means as far as life-giving for children and childbearing, and God does a miracle, much like he did with the virgin birth. But it wasn't a virgin birth. All right. Verse 5, and he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he said unto him, so this is the word of the Lord. So again, when we run into Genesis 18, it's going to be fairly obvious that this angel of the Lord, some would call it the theophany, the word of the Lord, is going to be with two angels. And it's God himself. It's the Father himself. All right. And so takes him abroad. He brought him forth abroad. Now, was this supernatural like Ezekiel? You know, sometimes in Ezekiel's ministry, God would just kind of pick Ezekiel up by the hair or the head and take him, you know. Or like Philip in Acts chapter 8. Seems like that, but maybe it was a journey, you know. And he says, look at the stars. Now, with light pollution, we really don't get this. Last night on the way home from our daughter work in Blakely, I was cutting across on a certain road, and I just pulled over and looked at the stars. I mean, I was in the middle of nowhere, and you could see the Milky Way, unless it was a cirrus cloud, but it looked like the Milky Way. And so when there's no light pollution, I mean, you can see enormous amounts of stars. And think about it. God compares the stars with the sand of the sea in number. So you need to do that sometime, is get out in the middle of nowhere on a clear, still night and look up. And it does lead you to God. I can see why people who live in major cities, this is just a demographic truth, like in the United States of America, the more urban you are, the less you believe in God. The more rural you are, the more you believe in God. And a big part of that, it's very difficult to live in nature and not know that there is a symbiotic relationship that couldn't have evolved and had to be a creation from God. We're in your urban area. I mean, you're just around people all the time. You're around concrete. You're around what man has made, man-made things. Light pollution, you're not able to look at the stars, and you know, God's spirit is still there. God still tugs on the human heart, don't get me wrong, but there's less, it seems, natural theology and natural revelation. All right, so verse 5 brought him out, look at the stars, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. So the word of the Lord, Abraham believes what the word of the Lord is telling him, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. He said that is going to happen. Now you're going to run into this again in primarily Romans and Galatians, this phraseology, maybe a little bit in Hebrews as well, but primarily by far Romans and Galatians, that this is this massive New Testament concept. Now a lot of people bring up, well, this was before circumcision. Circumcision is a type of water baptism, so you're saved before water baptism. The two are totally irrelevant. God made the new birth experience, being born of water and spirit, remission of sins, the different Great Commission scriptures in the New Testament to tell us about this new covenant. And so the new covenant is, even though it has as a basis the Abrahamic covenant, is totally divorced from it in a certain sense, as far as, you know, the application and the entering in of the covenant. So it was accounted unto him for righteousness. So this doesn't mean the second you think on Jesus, you believe on Calvary, you're in and you can never be lost. This is contrary to scripture. This is not how anybody came to God throughout the pages of Holy Writ from the birthday of the church on. So we have to look at how they applied Jesus' words. A lot of people say you can't get doctrine out of narrative. That is a short shrift. That is a, as they used to say, a Jesuitical way of putting things. That's just not true. Narrative portions of scripture show us how the words of Jesus were applied, not just in theological jargon or puzzle pieces trying to put together, but how did the apostles actually live out the life, and what was the dynamic faith of the early church? And you find that it was Acts 2:38 was the entrance way into the church. And this is even why the liturgical churches have semblances of Acts 2:38, echoes of it, as I've done in many videos before, mentioned that. In confirmation and the essentiality of baptism and this type of thing. So, you know, Brother Latta, he would always have this famous, the stars of heaven would be the church, the sand by the seashore that's mentioned in other passages of the Abrahamic covenant would be earthly Jerusalem, earthly Israel. So he was saying your seed's going to be, have an earthly component and a spiritual component, given birth by New Jerusalem, which is above, which is the mother of us all, according to Galatians. Okay, so let's go into verse 6. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Verse 7, and he said unto him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. Now notice, verse 4, and behold, the word of the Lord came unto him. The famous Mimre of Jehovah, Edersheim tells us about, basically, again, the equivalent of the Logos in the New Testament. And I am Jehovah, I am the Lord, all caps, tetragrammaton, the four letters, as we've mentioned many times. I am the Lord. So the word of the Lord is the Lord, even here, comparing verse 4 and 7, that brought thee out of Ur the Chaldees, light, Ur means light, to give thee this land to inherit it. And so it was a gradual thing, and he got it over the course of time. Now, we're going to try to make these in little bite-sized pieces, like 5 minutes. I think I've gone over 5 minutes here, but so you can just kind of come get a five-minute Bible study accurately, line by line, representing the truths of the Word of God. We love you. I hope you pray. I hope you read the Word of God. And the Bible says, study to show yourself approved. And to preachers, it says, preach the Word. So God bless. Talk with you later in Jesus' name.